you think about science, what comes to mind? Perhaps it's physics and astronomy to really understand the orbits and motions of objects like the planets, as well as structures and engineering. Perhaps what came to mind was researchers who are hard at work at their lab benches to understand the properties of cells, as well as chemical reactions. And maybe you even thought about statistics to understand how trends and data can be used to model and predict future events over time. But I want to stop to ask you, what about art? My name is Julian Zulueta, and I'm a current sophomore at MIT studying biological engineering with a minor in the history of art, architecture, and design. And a lot of times people always comment about this interesting mix and asking what are the connections between the two fields. So today, I want you to walk with me through the streets of Miami to see what I see and understand that how we can view the two fields in an analytical, functional, and educational approach will ultimately help us when developing and designing solutions for our modern day society. Let's go. On our first stop, I want us to approach from an analytical perspective and think about one of your favorite paintings, whether it be a painting by Van Gogh or Monet, or even a building that you appreciate. And think about the questions and items that draw it to you. Maybe it's the subjects, the colors, or even the messages that the artists are trying to draw to you. And those questions are the ones that derive meaning to us, because art allows us to take an inwards approach that allows us to reflect on what we find. And a lot of times we limit these questions to the context of museums or artistic environments, and we don't extend the discussions far enough. And this can have implications within science, where when we're looking at science, we're looking at an approach from a problem to solution-based method, looking at how we can go from a deficiency in energy to what can we do. We can increase through solar panels, fossil fuels, and finding ways that increase our energy needs, but we're not often asking the reflections and meanings behind these questions. And what science often does is we have these solutions, but we're not looking at who it's affecting and how. And that's where art comes into play. By bringing in the questions we would typically associate with a museum or a painting, we're asking questions about the humanities. We're asking questions about who are we affecting? Are we affecting all individuals equally? And making sure that when we're designing solutions, we're not just making sure we're ending a problem, but we're making sure that everyone has equal access to it and having an equitable benefit from this solution. For our next portion, I want to look at biomimicry and see how science and art are able to combine in functional aspects. And we can prominently see this through Japan, where engineers here have been able to innovate with new modes of transportation, including bullet trains. And these are great for the community because they allow citizens to travel from different locations throughout the country at high speeds. However, it often led to an inconvenience of high noises due to the sonic booms that were associated with bullet trains. Because when bullet trains travel at high speeds, they can generate pressure waves in tunnels that when they exit will ultimately travel at the speed of sound and create a sonic boom. So engineers were able to model these trains after their local environment, looking at kingfishers and their beaks. When they modeled the train with the elongation of the kingfisher's beak, they were able to allow their community to enjoy the speeds of a bullet train without the associated noise. Furthermore, we can see how other parts of the world are using biomimicry in their day-to-day activities, such as Zimbabwe and its Eastgate Center. Due to the high heat of this area, energy costs can often skyrocket and make it unaffordable for natural ventilation. So what engineers have been able to do is look at termite mounds and model buildings after them. Here, they're able to have cold air rush through the bottom of the building and rise throughout. And by doing so, the entire building will be able to have natural ventilation with hot air rising and escaping from the building. And these are two ways that biomimicry has been able to design our world. And we can continue this conversation as we look at how science and art are able to be used throughout society. On our final stop, I want to ask us how we're looking at science and the way we're teaching people about it, not only in the way that we're looking at it in classrooms, but the way that we communicate it through research and presentations, because this can affect who is understanding our research and how we're able to bring it to the table when we're designing our world. And recent studies have looked at this, especially at Johns Hopkins University, where they were looking at how students were engaging with science and learning it better. So what they did is they had two groups of students and they were able to ask, how were students learning science? One group of students were learning science from the traditional way we associate, so whether they were looking at it from a textbook, data, visuals, and graphs. And another group of students continued to learn the same material, but they were able to learn science from ways that were more humanities-based approach. And this was often more individual to their own interests. And things that they would do was often make fun ways of learning this, whether it be songs or even like drawings, ways that were able to stick with them and allow them to appreciate the material for what it is. And what they found is that while both students were able to learn the material, students who were engaging it, the science, with a more humanities-based approach were actually able to appreciate the material a little more and understand the material up to 3 months later. And they would often remember this through the same songs that they used when they were learning the material. And what we see is that if we extend this to the way that we approach science, not only in classrooms, but the way we discuss it and extend our observations to others, more people can be invited to the field and appreciate the actual science. We can have people not associate science as a daunting field with graphs, numbers, and even daunting acronyms like CDKs and words like lymphocytes. But we can have it be more fun and engaging for everyone to appreciate, understand, and be a part of. And this is what we need when we're developing more solutions in our society, because we're not just limiting it to one group of scientists who have studied the field, but everyone should be a part of this. And that's what the importance of bringing both fields of science and art does. It allows everyone to have a piece of the table and understand what can they bring. In conclusion, what I want to bring to you is that science doesn't need to be the field that we restrict to just numbers and data, but it can be more than that. It can be a field that's fun and engaging for everyone. And we can do this by bringing in other questions that we've seen here today, whether we're looking at it from an analytical, functional, or educational approach, because by doing so, we're able to extend our conversations further. And we see this when we're looking at art. By bringing in those questions that we would have not traditionally asked, we're able to extend science to consider other perspectives, not just the solutions we have, but who are we affecting and why. We're also able to look at it from the functional approach, the way that we're designing buildings, the way that we're designing solutions. Are they really making sure that they're functional, and are they aesthetically pleasing? And that's a fun way that we can design science for everyone to appreciate and enjoy. And we also see this in the educational manner. We see that by making sure science is fun and engaging, all people have a share and all people should be interested in the field. And this was personal to me because as I grew up, I think a lot of times what drew me to science wasn't necessarily just the numbers and the data, but it was looking at my own city, looking at my own backyard, whether it be the Wynwood walls or even the grass, the roots, and understanding soils in my class labs and seeing how light affects color and so forth. Because by looking at these fun ways of approaching science, we're looking at it from a more realistic perspective that's intuitive to all people. And this can be fun because when we're bringing more people to the table, we're increasing the perspectives that we have in this field and who's really considering science. We're making sure it's more equitable for everyone to have a share and really participate in the field. And that's what I want to challenge you. Whether you're looking at physics, whether you're looking at data, whether you're looking at numbers or any field in science, how can we extend this further to make sure that everyone has a part? What can you do, whether you're looking to bring in art or any other humanities-based field that's intuitive for all people to enjoy? So with that, I hope you guys enjoyed the talk, and thank you for watching.